Good evening, everyone. I'm presenting a new case which I saw last month, that is choroidal hemangioma. The history is a 29-year-old male came to our OPD with the chief complaint of sudden onset painless diminution of vision in the left eye for the past 1 year. He was diagnosed elsewhere as a tubercular choroidal granuloma and treated with oral steroids and ATT, which the patient took for 2 months and then discontinued. He came here for further management. On examination, the right eye vision was 6/6 N6 and the left eye vision was counting fingers at 1 meter. Rest of the anterior segment examination was normal. A fundus examination for the left eye showed a solitary well-defined orange-colored lesion in the posterior pole, a subretinal lesion, which was temporal to the fovea of size 8 disc diameter. Superiorly and temporally in the lesion, we can see surface metaplastic changes that are suggestive of chronicity. And inferiorly, there is the presence of SRF. The following investigations were done: ultrasound, FFA, ICG, and MRI brain and orbit. On ultrasound, there was a retinal detachment along with a dome-shaped retinochoroidal mass, which had high surface and internal reflectivity, and the echogenicity was similar to the surrounding choroid with the following dimensions. Basal, horizontal basal 7.9 mm, vertical basal 6.7 mm, and the height of the lesion was 3.06 mm. FFA and ICG was done. FFA in the early phase showed lacy hyperfluorescence, which continued till the late phase. And ICG, early ICG showed vascular filling of the lesion, which continued till the late phase with areas of with some areas of hyperfluorescence in late ICG. MRI was done. The axial T1, we can see a hyper intense lesion in the left eye with respect to the vitreous. The axial T2 flare image also shows a hyper intense lesion, and there is post contrast enhancement of the lesion. The differential diagnosis for this lesion can be an amelanotic choroidal melanoma, choroidal metastasis, CSR, and choroidal granuloma. So I've learned how to examine and describe a choroidal lesion, the various investigations to be done, and significance of the investigations. Thank you.
Dr. Diyadi here.
Yes, ma'am.
You described this lesion as some orange-shaped lesion.
Yes, ma'am.
But looking at the fundus, it does not look very much orange lesion at all.
Okay, ma'am.
Could you maybe describe it a little bit better?
You can show the image and describe it again.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Ma'am, it is a well-circumscribed lesion in the posterior pole, subretinal lesion, which has an orangish hue.
Have you seen a typical choroidal hemangioma?
No, ma'am. This is the only case that I have seen.
Have you seen a photo of any typical choroidal hemangioma, circumscribed hemangioma?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Do you think this resembles a typical choroidal hemangioma?
No, ma'am. But this has been treated.
This is treated with what? Oral ATT.
And anti-VEGF injections were given elsewhere.
Okay. Alright, but the appearance is not of typical choroidal hemangioma. So I think you should describe the appearance a little bit better so that people know that this can be confused with something else other than hemangioma. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Then you see a lot of yellow pigmentation around, even on top of the hemangioma, and on the temporal side there is some whitish, probably some scar tissue or something. Okay. And yes, also, sir, can you go to your ultrasound?
Yes, ma'am.
So in this is the only image you have of ultrasound?
Yes, ma'am.
So in the ultrasound, can you see behind that choroidal elevation, you see a distinct eculucency?
Yes, ma'am.
What is that due to? Can you maybe explain that?
No, ma'am.
So is it wrong to have a differential diagnosis of a choroidal tubercle in this? So this, I feel that probably we should explore some inflammatory pathology here, because there is a clear area of eculucency which is there around the scleral cords, and this can possibly due to some kind of inflammation. So, yeah, and clinically it does not look like typical choroidal hemangioma. Maybe Sugneshwari will be in a better position to comment.
Ma'am, in choroidal hemangioma, if it is a post-treated patient, the surface changes will be there. So, the changes are not very uncommon. We do get these changes, and like the fact that this lesion, which is a very flat lesion, if you see with a height which is not more, and as I already pointed out, the circumference is more here, and apart from that, the sclera which is widened. You are right, if the sclera is widened, it can be an inflammatory pathology. Sometimes it can be choroidal lesions also which can present like this. But the clinical picture of this patient is quite a typical picture of a hemangioma. It's not an inflammatory pathology in this one. Because if you see in an inflammatory pathology, the if it is a granuloma, the tumor will look very different. The echogenicity will be different. It will not be this very solid types. Here you see the uniform echogenicity which is there. If it is an abscess, you may have sometimes a fluid level. But if it is a granuloma, it can have varying reflectivity. But this is like quite uniform if we see. Except for the fact that we have the sclera which is like a little widened immediately posterior to the tumor itself. Can you show me the picture one more time?
Yes, ma'am.
Has any treatment been done for this patient before?
Ma'am, oral steroids, ATT, and the patient has taken anti-VEGF injections.
Ah, so that is what. So when the injections are given, then they always undergo surface changes. That's what we are seeing on the superior margin of it. If you see the superior margin, you can see the changes which are there. And even when we do a post-TTT also, you may have these kind of surface changes. But only one point which is going against is the sclera.
No. Could that be just the inferior oblique muscle that is imaged behind the macula?
Because this is a longitudinal scan. The axial scan picture is there?
No, ma'am.
Only this longitudinal scan is there, huh?
Yes, ma'am.
But it is not looking like very clear cut, because little above the muscle also what we are seeing is the quiet widening is also there. But what is the contrast picture of this patient? Contrast was done?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir. I think what you're imaging is the inferior oblique, because echolucency behind the tumor would be directly behind the tumor. It will not go at an angle.
Yes, this is going at an angle. Correct.
Totally going at an angle. And the only thing is, are you calling that other membrane a retinal detachment?
Yes,
that
is
yes,
a
ma'am.
Yeah.
But the only thing is, retinal detachment is fine, but for a choroidal hemangioma to have subretinal echoes like this, to my mind, is a little unusual.
That superiorly, whatever is there, that's looking like an inflammatory reaction, that fibrosis thing which is around the margin.
No, the echoes behind the membrane, behind the RD. Usually a choroidal hemangioma, the retinal detachment, the subretinal space is echolucent.
Yes, ma'am. They will not have much inflammatory echoes.
Yeah, but the scleral widening is just the inferior oblique.
That periphery, what we are seeing, that fibrosis also doesn't very much correlate with the hemangioma, because we don't get that much changes. Very minimal we get, but not like this.
What else was done for the patient? Because sometimes you get metaplasia on the surface. The ICG is fairly typical.
No, the this one, MRI with contrast will be the best modality in this, ma'am. That will only help us properly. Where is the MRI contrast?
Ma'am, the last image.
Yes.
SSOCT was done to the presenter, ma'am. Would it have helped?
See, usually when you have to differentiate between hemangioma and a melanoma, the gold standard is contrast is MRI. That is what is the ideal modality if we are differentiating. But now here we are thinking about whether we are dealing with an inflammatory pathology, whether it's a granuloma, only thing, because that fibrosis doesn't occur this extensive. Even if it is treated with a TTT also, so much of surface changes will not occur. That is one thing which is a little different. But again, going by anti-VEGF and all these things, also it will reduce, but it should not cause so much fibrosis. And this MRI which is having contrast also is not very typical of hemangioma.
Ma'am, and post anti-VEGF, we usually see reduction in SRF or cystic spaces. Only anti-VEGF can induce surface changes, ma'am, like other than laser or TTT or radiotherapy.
No, anti-VEGF will not induce so much surface changes at all, never. Unless and until we have done radiation, only then that will reduce. Anti-VEGF does not. It can reduce your subretinal fluid, but not this one. This MRI is also not very classical.
Yes, thank you.
I think for all tumors, an orbital scan of the ultrasound should be done. And that I think that is important, because only then we will be clear about the muscles and retroorbital space. And second thing is, now there is a request for everybody that please put only one image on one slide, because the image is quite minified for us. Even this MRI scan, we can hardly make out anything. So if you just put one image, that is little bit magnified and we can see it properly.
Was only one photograph taken for this patient? No, because you are making a diagnosis of exudative RD due to choroidal hemangioma based on that ultrasound image also. Yes, there are certain other requisites to make a diagnosis of exudative RD.
Sir, ma'am, shifting feet to supine and sitting position, we have to do the USGV scan.
Yeah. So I think points well taken, that these are learning points, but maybe a little more understanding of the findings would be better. Because if you are talking about exudative retinal detachment, you have to demonstrate that the retinal detachment is moving with change in position of the patient. Yeah, I think that's probably documentation is a little bit lacking in this patient in terms of ultrasound, because we are basing a lot of our diagnosis on the ultrasound. The ICG is very nicely showing that the tumor is lighting up and there is some choroidal vessel dilatation. There's a lot of choroidal hyperpermeability on your ICG as well. But I think since you're looking at an imaging case, next time get a little more representative images so that we are not left guessing. What was done for this patient eventually?
Ma'am, TTT was done.
TTT was done. Patient has come for follow-up, or this is just
no, ma'am. This is a recent case.
A recent case. Okay.